turn on all the things.
Battery, right? I'll talk to you yourself. Battery light is red, is that bad?
No, that's good.
That's good.
Check your connection. Give me 1 second.
All right.
Hey.
Hey. You know, you may think, well, I tell you what, these young guys do a lot more than you realize. Man, we would be lost without all the production and things that we do to try to make this excellent for you guys. Let's give them a hand. Setting it up and tearing it down. And this particular microphone was preach on with both locations, so it's in transit. There's just a lot that happens around here, a lot more serving than people realize. And speaking of serving, I wanted to start out today by recognizing, unfortunately, Miss Gail's sister passed away, Miss Chauncey's aunt passed away this week, which is unfortunate, and we continue to support them. But I wanted to specifically thank everybody who either you cooked something or you came and you served this week. We were able to feed the family afterward. That was an honor and a privilege to feed you guys and to feed your family and get to meet some of them we haven't met. And even on a sad occasion, when we get together, sometimes we can smile and laugh a little bit, especially around some good food. So if you cooked something this week, and I was proud of the men who cooked. I'm going to tell you, there was some good cooking not only from the ladies of House of Grace, but from the men.
Yeah.
Freddie made a pancake that was smart. Yeah, I ate some. We served everybody and then we ate. But if you cooked or you served, would you stand up and let me recognize you? You guys thank these people for looking around. Yeah, come on up. Oh, yeah, we got you. Yes, 12. Somebody say 12.
12.
Pastor Larry, you didn't. Oh. Okay, well. Let's see. I need you too. We'll work it out. We'll work this out. I'll tell you what. Trey, if you got to hear what? No, you don't have to hear. You don't have to hear. All you have to do is just sit here. I'll tell you what. I don't want to kick it. Y'all are just so good. Look, we'll do one more. Bring a chair with you. We're going to do an extra one. I got your chair. Come on up. I'll tell you what. Christian, if you will, you sit right up here by Pastor Shane. Pastor Larry, that's your chair. Yeah, you need to be there. All right, now, John chapter 13, you have it?
Yes.
All right, let's look at John chapter 13. You guys are going to be here for a while. Get comfortable. You might want to go take your shoes off. Get comfortable. And we're going to throw John 13 on the screen. Let's see here. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that this hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. I'm going to love y'all to the end today. Everybody's going to die. No, that's not it. During supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going back to God, Paul's right there, so if you haven't figured it out, these 12 plus one are going to represent the 12 disciples that were here with Jesus that night. Now, it's already mentioned that one of them is going to betray Jesus. One of them is named what?
Peter.
Which one of these guys you think? Nah, I'm kidding. All right, that's it. All right, going on. Jesus rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments. All right. And he took a towel and he tied it around his waist. I'm not going to tie anything around my waist. All right, he took a towel, tied it around his waist, and then what did he do? He poured water into a basin and began to wash whose feet?
The disciples.
And we're talking about serving. Somebody say, you got served.
You got served.
You're going to need those shoes off, Pastor Larry. Yeah, y'all going to wish you went first. Don't worry, we're going to get rid of the water this time. Keep the sanitary for your amazing feet. All right, so if you will, go ahead. You guys be removing some shoes. I want to show you what serving looks like. Jesus modeled serving for us, right? Serving is what love looks like. Say that one time with me. Serving is what love looks like. So the Bible says that Jesus took one of their feet. Now, we'll say that this is Peter. Pastor Larry would be Peter. All right, let's read a little farther. And he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, do you wash my feet? Jesus answered him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand. Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answered him and said, if I do not wash you, you have no share with me. You know how Peter was always kind of dramatic, so here's what he said. Lord, do not wash my feet only, but my hands and my hair. Jesus said, settle down, Peter. He said, the one who has bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, not every one of you. And he was referring to that their heart was clean. They were obedient to the Lord, but there was a Judas in the room. Let's move forward. For he knew who was to betray him. That's why he said, not all of you are clean. Verse 12. When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If then your Lord and teacher have washed your feet, you also, somebody say
you also
ought to wash one another's feet. That's interesting, isn't it? Now, a lot of people make this story into almost a doctrine and a tradition to say that, you know, we have to wash each other's feet There's nothing wrong with that per se. In some churches, I've been friends with pastors, and every time they take communion, they do a foot washing. You ever been to an old school foot washing? Nothing wrong with that. I don't think that was the point to make it a tradition. It was to make a teaching. So let's read a little farther. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done it to you. All right. So, what we're going to do, as I watch these men's amazing feet, look at these feet. Are these good feet or what? And I'm not going to be scrubbing between the toes or anything like that. We're going to keep it simple. I'm just going to rest their feet and dry it off, and they'll stay up here with us, and we'll just kind of go down the line. But I want you to just ask the Holy Spirit to show you, where are some feet, not literal feet, but where are some feet that you need to wash out? This week, I want you to be
a foot finder.
Looking for ways that you can serve others. So, I want to give you some notes and things to write down that have to do with serving. As you're looking for dirty feet this week, there's three things you have to understand about serving. First of all, you are called to serve.
Yes.
Somebody said that I'm called to serve.
I am called to serve.
Now, when you're called to serve, that doesn't mean like when your phone rings, and it's somebody at work and you don't want to answer it, and you click the button that sends them the voicemail. It's not that kind of call. It's like a command. God has called you to serve. Thank you, Pastor. Next man. Somebody say, I'm called to serve.
I am called to serve.
I want you to realize that the call actually has a command to it. It's not like, well, I wonder if I should serve. Awesome. Maybe I wonder if God's calling you to serve. You think so? Russell, I wonder if God's calling you to serve. Ryan, you think God's calling you to serve? See, God has called you. And when God calls, it's serious. He's called you to serve. Now, besides being called to serve, you may feel like I've had men say, well, I feel like I'm called to preach. Hey, praise God. We need people who are called to preach. Or I'm called to be a Christian businessman. Or I'm called to be a doctor. Well, those are all noble callings. But understand, you might want to write this down. Sometimes you get a calling that you're not yet qualified for. See, sometimes you get a calling for something, but you're going to need some training.
That's right.
The first air conditioner you worked on, did they just give you some tools and say, go fix that? No, somebody had to say, this is an air conditioner. Ryan, in your job, I know they don't let you lose in corrections without some training, too many liabilities. So a lot of times we're called to something, but we're not yet qualified for what we're called for.
That's good.
And you need to understand that there's sometimes a season of preparation between your now and your then. But not so with serving. You're called today to serve, and guess what? You're qualified right now to serve. You don't need to go take another class. You don't need a certification. You don't need a degree. All you need is a yes.
Amen.
You're called to serve, and you're qualified to serve. Look at the person and say, you qualify. Let's say, what you waiting on? Look at your other servant. So you're called to serve, and you're qualified to serve. The real question is, are you committed to serve? Are you committed to serve? That's really a hard thing, isn't it? Jan said earlier this morning, she said that serving brings you joy. Thank you, sir. Next man. Funny thing, last night I was on a daddy-daughter date with my girls, Jillian and Riley, my two oldest. The ladies had their dig thing at our house and basically kicked me out of the house.
Yeah.
I said, you can't stop me, we'll go to Cheddar's. So we go to Cheddar's last night, and Jillian and Riley and I, we were talking, and they were telling me that they had been cleaning the house. I guess because Laura wanted to clean for all the ladies coming over here. I don't know. And so the girls have been cleaning the house, and Jillian and Riley were telling me a funny story about how Hosanna, you know, I have five daughters. Hosanna is three. And she sees things a little bit different than I see them sometimes. And they were in the bathroom, and there's a thing in our bathroom called a toilet. And it needed cleaning. And Jillian and Riley, I think Riley was in there cleaning the toilet. And Hosanna was like, I want to help clean the toilet. Please let me scrub the toilet, please. She said, I haven't got to do it yet. She was very excited about this opportunity. Cleaning the toilet. And we laughed about that, you know, and then we were sitting there at the table, and I looked at Riley and Jillian, and I said, why do you think she was so excited about cleaning the toilet? And I just paused like a wise dad that I am. And they sat there for a minute, and Riley said, you're going somewhere with this. Some kind of, Jillian said, some kind of wise life lesson. Just go ahead and tell us. So I let him ponder a minute. That's what dads do. Thank you, son. God bless you. And I said, well, it's just interesting to me that Hosanna was looking at the same situation you were looking at, but she had a different perspective. She was looking at the same toilet you were looking at, yet she was excited about cleaning it where you were dreading it. Same situation, different perspective. Serving is what love looks like. But then Jillian made another point. She said, yeah, but she doesn't know what's been in that toilet. I said, that's fair. That's fair. Sometimes our knowledge and sometimes living life and being around people and having experienced some hurts and some betrayals and some of us have some wounds in our back. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Where it can sometimes make us a little jaded. So we have to pray, thank you, sir, that God would help us to have Hosanna's perspective and not our perspective.
Yes, that's a good word.
Because serving is what love looks like. So we're called to serve. We're qualified to serve. Just a person probably committed to serve. I wanted to give you some kind of some nuggets on serving that you might want to make some notes of. The first one is serving may not come natural for you. I don't feel very natural right now. Did you know that? Would you? This is a grown man's foot in my hand. Love you. God bless you. But even though it doesn't seem natural, it does feel natural. Because this is what love looks like. It's serving. So another nugget would be serving is a choice. You have to choose to serve. So this week, will you choose to serve? Will you find you some feet? Thank you, sir. Another nugget is serving is the foundation of leadership. Pastor Shane and I have talked about this a lot, and I know I've heard it talk to youth in the past and have some young person come up and say, I'd really like to be a leader. What do I need to do to be a leader? And he would say, start serving. And that doesn't not always the way I like to do it. I kind of like a title. You know, maybe somebody to recognize me on the stage. Maybe write a song in my honor or something. I don't know. But that's not usually how you get to be a leader. Jesus talks so often about, he said, if you want to be a leader, then you have to be a servant. In fact, we meet people on a regular basis. Maybe they move to town, they come from a different church or different background, or whatever the case. I meet people every now and then. They say, I'd like to be this, I'd like to be that. It's some type of leadership, or some type of role of significance. Thank you. Thank you. Watch it again. I'll watch it again, brother. Because I'm here to serve. You ever been to Chick-fil-A? And when you say thank you, what do they say? It's my pleasure. You don't know. Serving is what love called to serve. We're qualified to serve. Are we committed to serve? Serving is a choice. Serving may not come naturally. But there is a joy in serving. We joke about it. But there is a joy. Thank you, brother. I'm stealing mics in my notes. Oh, yeah, let me tell you this one. Serving should meet a need. Serving should meet a need. Sometimes I find something that's a little convenient for me, and I give myself some brownie points because I say that I serve somebody, but I really didn't meet a need. Serving should meet a need. Amen?
Amen.
Another thing is serving should cost you something. Serving should cost you something. If it doesn't cost you anything, well, that's kind of cool, though. If it doesn't cost you anything, it's not serving. In a minute, I want to tell you about the difference between serving and work. But serving should be done cheerfully. If you can't serve cheerfully, I'm not going to say don't serve. I'm going to say don't serve yet. Go pray and ask God to change your heart. Ask God to give you His eyes for that dirty thing. Amen? Serving should be done cheerfully because serving is what love looks like. Let me tell you about the difference between serving and working. I have confused the two. I have done work before and again credited myself. And so it's like I give myself a much better grade, I think, than possibly God gives me sometimes. I grade on the curve and there's lots of extra credit. But I just wonder how God grades. But serving and working are different because serving is when you do something with no expectation of reciprocation or reward from the other person. Hand me your foot, Lee. Now, Lee, if I wash your foot here, I want you to go hold that little chin. Let's do a little more. All right. Now, Lee, since I'm washing your feet, I'm going to do a real good job, okay? What I need this week is maybe I can come by your massage therapist. You know, and maybe if I could, what are you doing Tuesday around two? I might just come by for an hour. It's usually different. And, you know, does this feel good? Are you pleased with that? Is that good? Okay, let me see. I'm going to do a good job because I love you. And maybe, you know, maybe I could get a massage or something. I'm just thinking, maybe, you know what I mean? Is that serving?
No.
That's actually manipulation.
That's right.
When I serve so that I can receive from a person. Now, the Bible does say that there are heavenly rewards for serving. There is a heavenly account for my actions. I will be rewarded for my serving, but if I'm looking for you to reward me for serving you, I'm either an employee or a manipulator.
Yeah, that's good.
See, if I serve you so that you can reward me, if you work at McDonald's and you're serving there, that's good. You're supposed to serve. And they're going to give you a paycheck. If they don't, you should quit. Go to Wendy's. Thank you, sir. That's an employee-employer relationship. That's working. But serving is it's not people reward-based. I'm just serving out of the love. I want to show you that I love you, so I'm serving. Amen? Thank you. Serve. It's love and action. If you have a Bible, because I don't have our, I tell you what, if you're able to find Matthew 20, verse 26 through 28. Matthew 20, verse 26 through 28. Nice book you have here, sir. I should have told these guys ahead of time so I could have had that extra 20 feet. But that wouldn't be serving, would it? You have Matthew 20?
Not yet.
Not yet. All right. I told you there's pleasure in serving. don't have it in school, I'll tell you what it says. Jesus, in Matthew 20, verse 26 through 28, he said, in the world, the way to get ahead is to get on top of things. You've kind of got to step on, I'm paraphrasing now. You step on people's head, do whatever you got to do to be great. He said, but in the kingdom of God, it's different. To be great, thank you, God bless you, you have to serve. You can stay right here. The last but not the least. In the world, the way to get ahead is to try to be great. But in the kingdom of God, if you want to be great, you have to do what? You have to serve. And that's what Matthew 20 talks about. In Romans 12:1, you remember Romans 12:1 says that. Actually, I'd like to read it to you if I can get up. Romans 12:1. We're wrapping this up. We talk about Romans 12:2 a lot. Because you know, Romans 12:2, it says, and do not be conformed to this world, be transformed by the renewing of your. I quote that often. But I'd like to quote Romans 12:1 today. It says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies, your what? A living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable what?
Service.
Your reasonable what?
Service.
Yes. Your bodies. And I would like you to underline, if you don't write in your Bible, this would be really fun for you. Underline the word living and the word sacrifice. You know, that's kind of like an oxymoron. Those are two words that don't go together. Sacrifice was something that you place on, you killed it and placed it on the altar. Sacrifice has an implication of it's dead. That's why I said dead. So if you have a sacrifice, you killed something. So to say a living sacrifice, it's a very foreign term in this day, you know, when he wrote that. That was really like, whoa, what did you say? It's kind of like saying, hey, that's a white black, or that's a nighttime, daytime, or that's a red, blue. You would just be like, wait a minute, what did he say? That would be an attention grabber. To say something is a living sacrifice. Let's read it again. I beseech you, therefore, brother, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies. Now, what is it that he's wanting us to have as a living sacrifice? Our bodies, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And then we would normally read on and he would say, don't be conformed to this world. And so we use that verse, and it would fit. We use that to say, hey, don't do bad stuff. Make your bodies a living sacrifice to the Lord. That's your reasonable service. That's the least you can do in response to what Jesus has done for you. You know, and somebody said, quit doing bad stuff. I'm making up things, you know. Don't do drugs. Don't get porn. Don't cheat on your wife. Don't cheat on your husband. Don't steal from your job. Those are all good ideas not to do. But then the rest of the chapter says, verse 3, for I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt with each one. And he goes on the rest of the chapter talking about how the members of the church should serve one another. The whole chapter is not just about, quit, you know, doing bad things and don't cuss at work or whatever. That's really not what it's about. Part of holiness is living a life of servitude, of serving one another. He said, let your bodies be a living sacrifice. That's your reasonable service. Don't be conformed to this world. Don't think of yourselves like that. The world thinks of themselves first and usually themselves only. He said, but because you're part of the church, the body of Christ, let me teach you what the members of Christ do for one another. They serve one another. So they walk around as living sacrifices. Instead of walking into the room going, what can I get? What do I want? How do I feel? What do I like? We are such a society. Me too. We constantly are trying to determine what we like. Think about it. Maybe this morning, I bet 80% of you have either decided you're too cold right now or you're too hot. It's true. You've either said, man, it's kind of hot in here. I don't think I like it. Or you said, well, it's a little too cold. I wish they'd turn that down. I don't like it. That's how how we are. We're always, if we go to a restaurant, we're going, I don't. You know, when I ate Fred and Julie's pound cake yesterday, I went, I like it. But really, who cares what we like? We're so focused on what I like, what I want, what I need. What I need! I need chocolate a lot. These things I like, I need, I want. It's so much focused about me. But what if I went around and said, is there anybody here maybe who they have a need? Like, what does he need? You're like, well, who can I serve? I'll tell you how you can apply this. You can start at home, and I'm going to preach to me for a minute. I can say, what does my wife need? Because if I love my wife, a lot of people say, oh, I love my wife. I provide. I go to work. I bring home the bacon. I put bread on the table. I show her that I love her. And that's good. We need to do that. The Bible says a man that doesn't work should eat. So we need to work. I get it. But is that the best I can do? To show her that I love her? Is that all I got? I've met husbands who said, hey, I work. Well, whoop-de-doo. You were born to work. You were made to work. We wouldn't be fulfilled if we didn't work. We work really because that's how we're wired. We find satisfaction because we're made to work. We're men. But that's not all that love looks like. Serving is what love looks like. So, you know, after 3 days of not taking out the trash this week, it got a little out of hand at my house. And yesterday, Laura called me. She's getting ready for that women's thing. She said, hey, what would you suggest? She wasn't mean about it. She said, what would you suggest that I do about this trash? That's code for a lot of things. I said, maybe I suggest you take it out.
I didn't say that.
Y'all know better than that. I said, you know what I suggest? You just leave it right where it is, baby, because I'm getting in the car right now, and I'm going to come get it. I'm going to take it off. And I took care of it. Because I knew that if I'm preaching on it, serving is what loving looks like, and I love this woman more than anybody on the planet, then surely I will find a way to serve her. Serving is what love looks like. Providing is the beginning. Serving is what they're looking for. Can I get an answer from the wives? Good luck, guys. When you get home. Let's just watch some more feet. But you know, serving, I truly believe that if I can find ways to serve my wife, that she's going to feel love. It's one thing to know your love, it's another thing to feel your love. They need to feel that we love them, not just know that we love them. Well, I know he loves me, but he never. What about our kids? And this is for all, it's not being of the husbands. Same room of the wives. We, you know, we also want to be served. And they're going, we know. But what about our children? Can we find ways to serve our kids? I've been known to be too busy. But I'm saying, Lord, help me to find a way to serve my kids. I don't want to just train them. We've got to train our kids up. But I get that. I can quote scripture too. But I also need to learn to serve them. They need to see me serve them. I need to try to meet a need for them. What can I do to help them? Now, I'm not saying I should meet every need, a lot of them, and raise them to be totally dependent on me so they live with me until they're 45. That's not what I'm saying. But I need to find ways to serve. Amen? What about work? What I know I mentioned earlier about the employer relationship, but let me tell you what I mean. A lot of times when we go to work, we find ways to serve the boss. Because, hey, let's be honest. We kind of want that guy to like us. You know, we kind of need favor from that lady or from that guy. And there's not necessarily anything wrong with that per se. As long as we're not getting into manipulation. But it's very common for people to go a little extra mile for the boss. But what about for the guy who sweeps up after you? What about for the lady who's cleaning your desk? What about for that person who's in the bathroom cleaning it and there's paper all over the floor by the trash can? Do you pick it up? Well, that ain't my job. No. That's the whole idea. If it was your job, it wouldn't be serving. It would be working. If you can find something that's not your job, or that's not expected, or that's not required, and you do that for somebody who's not just above you, but equal to you, or even better, below you in rank, if you can serve the ones below you in rank, I'm telling you, Jesus notices.
Yes.
He notices. He says, oh, somebody's getting it, because in my kingdom, to be great, you have to be the least. You have to serve. And I believe he kind of says, hey, let's see what he'll do with this. Let's see if he'll continue to serve. On a bad day, I mean, on a good day, I like to serve. I think about y'all, but on my bad day, I'm really not in the mood to serve. Did you know serving is not about your mood? Serving is about your calling. It's about your commitment. It's about my choice. Serving is what love looks like. And lastly, of course, we want to serve the community and our church. And that's the things we've been talking about lately, is finding ways. We've had the table back there. Pastor Shane's been saying, hey, could you help us at the Harvest Fest? You know, that thing is really not about a festival. It's about love. It's about love. We're investing time. We're investing money. We're investing effort. We're investing planning. We're trying to do the best job we can at loving this community. And that's just one way that we found that we could really go after them. Anytime we can get, they're already all going to be together, we would be wise to say, how can we serve them? Because we know that serving is what love looks like.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Hey, man, give these guys an amazing hand. You guys can be seated. Thank you so much for allowing me to do that. I had not prepared them for that. That was uncomfortable for them, I promise. Really an act of serving for them to let me do that. Serving is a privilege. Serving is an honor. This week, I want you to be a book finder. Looking for what you can do to serve. Looking for who you can serve. Amen. Is it, will you remember this?
Yeah.
I pray that this will be just seared to your memory. You'll see me with us. Yes. Nasty big feet in my hands. And you'll say, I'm going to find me some feet. Who can I serve in my family? Who can I serve in the church? Who can I serve in my job? Who can I serve? And find somebody you don't even know and serve. And just see what doors. Serving opens doors. Serving opens doors. Amen?
Amen.
All right. I'm going to ask Scott to come up and close this. And also, after he's done, we'll take the offering and the communication cards, which are our survey card this week.
Yes. That was a great verse. Can I give Pastor Joy a hand? I'm sure he would be say not to give him a hand for anything he did, but I say give him a hand for hearing what God has to say. And just to show you how important it is that he says what God tells him to do. He's been working on this for, you know, when God told him to. I don't know. But when John Brister talked to me over the weekend about getting up here and getting you guys set to do the tithe, and he said, well, and, you know, think about what you're going to do, how you're going to talk about it, all these things. Y'all know somewhere in this book? This was prior to his sermon. Matter of fact, it was actually, it happened this morning, because I had the idea that I'd get up here and talk about why I do tithe. And so I'll get on that real quick. You know, because of love. And you'll be like, that's so good. If you didn't already know that. But Dan and I, we've been serving God for a long time. And as the years go by, we serve more and more. And it's like anything as you grow. You work out, you grow more and more. As you do it more and more. You read the Word. You get the Word in you. You know the Word more and more. And you learn the Word. So we've been going at this thing for a good 12, 13 years. But we did not always get on the tithe train. There was a time where, you know, I would allow Satan to sit on my shoulder and talk to me about things, about why I shouldn't have the tithe and all this good stuff. And I'm only saying this because I know you've been there. Some of you might be there right now. But there came a time in serving God and allowing God to work on our hearts that there came a point in time that you get bought in. You get bought into what's going on around you. God don't need your money. Tithing is an opportunity for you to be bought in to his mission. Well, it takes money. Back in the day, it took cows and goats and all that good stuff, but today, you don't need to bring no goats and cows in here. We just take cash. And it's much easier that way. You know? We don't have to smell what goes on with that. But being bought in is what God gave me. And when I talk to John, I say, oh, yeah, that is so good. And then when I get to church this morning, I'm thinking about, oh, God, you know how I'm going to say this. And I went out to the truck, and I see my gloves there. And he said, take those with you. And that's going to be what you're talking about, is being a part of the team. You're to serve, and part of serving is tithing. Because if you don't tithe, you're not going to have the stuff to serve with to get to the people you're trying to get to. And so I brought my gloves in. And then Pastor Goy preached on serving. Now, I know, yes, it's another part of serving, but I did not realize what it's going to be all about. So that's God. God talks to you constantly, whether you know it or not. So as we get ready to tithe today, ask yourself, are you bought in? What do you tithe for? Are you tithing so you look good? So people will know that you're a tither. Are you doing it because you really are a part of what's going on? Because I know he is. He's sold out. I'm sold out. I take honor in serving you. I take honor in serving you, God. And I absolutely love it, just like I love serving my wife and my family. This is a part of the team. We are truly. I love seeing Mama B this morning when we were marched, when that the whole drum beat was going. You know, that was not rehearsed. You wouldn't believe it because it went so smooth, but that was not rehearsed. That's just God. That's how it works. But then the mother of our house gets up and leads you guys marching through here. I was like, yeah, this is good. So anyway, not to pull the graduates along, but keep serving. And your tithe is part of your serving. That's what keeps this house going, keeps your air conditioning going, so you can't complain whether it's hot enough or cold. And it's also how we go further out to reach further, not just right here. We come here to get equipped, and we go out there to serve the other. So, God, I thank you for the opportunity to be a part of your team, and our tithes to be a part of your team. You're such a gracious and wonderful God for what you do for us. You bless us beyond measure, Father. We're all a bunch of spoiled children under your watch. And God, I just thank you for this opportunity to tithe and to give back to our community as we serve the other. In Jesus' name. Amen. And while you guys are shooting your ties in, you can let it go. Don't forget your communication cards. They are very, very important.
Found out.